pound the ball. It's one of the best things they do. They're in the top in that. Their offense is rated in the top 15. Think about what I'm saying. And now you could say, well, who'd they play? Seton Hall beat us. They beat Seton Hall. They beat Michigan State. I mean, they're playing, when you talk even teams like Kent State was 8-1. I mean, they played quality teams, and they performed. Now, I think, again, you're right, our length kind of bothered them. And our length should bother a lot of people. But here's the other thing. We're just getting better and better, and it just takes time, and it's a process, and we win or we learn. So if everybody could get mad that I said that again, we win or we learn. When it's a process with these young guys, that's what it is. And the biggest thing is me trying to figure them out. I thought E.J. Montgomery was great today. Jamal Baker came in and helped us. Obviously, Tyler played, but he also rebounded. P.J. and Reed were strong, and, you know, Nick didn't get as many minutes today because E.J. played well. Well, I did some stuff today because when we drove a couple times, I'm like, holy geez, maybe we can drive these guys. I didn't think we could. My issue was they were going to drive us. And then we started playing, and he got by a guy, Keldon got by a guy, and then we opened up the offense a little bit and played a little different than we'd been playing. But he played well. But he also rebounded the ball. He ends up with 5 rebounds. But again, it was a low turnover game for us in a game like this, in this environment, against a team like that. There was a lot of good stuff that came out. PJ and Reed played good. I mean, they both played well.
How good was Ashton Higgins today, specifically kind of on the offensive end? It looked like he was a little bit more confident in the game.
Better. He called his own play. If you watched him, he came over and looked at me and said, Coach, fist out. I said, run it. And he went and scored a layup. This is becoming a player-driven team. They're not quite empowered yet because they don't hold each other accountable enough yet to be empowered totally. But it is a player-driven team. Practices have been player-driven. It's not me now. It's not me having to get them going or make them play. And, you know, there were some things today, and I told them after. Our issue right now is we have lapses. So we'll go through a 2 or 3 minute lapse. Like, what were you doing? Why weren't you playing? Some of it's letting up and acting like you won. Others are like decision making. We leave a corner and shoot a quick 3 to end a half. We're up 13. And all of a sudden you turn around and you walk in up 8 and they have the ball. That's anybody's ball game. So, and I told him, I said, that's a high school move, man. But this is a, I got a good team. I mean, I've had a good team. You know, I know our fans have loved this. All season, our fans have bragged about these kids and talked, about how good, and there was no room on the bandwagon. So, what happened? What just happened? Yeah.
What do you hope, he can learn?
He doesn't do it again. But the other one was the Ashton talking to one of their guys in a game you're going to win. So what, you're going to get a technical, something's going to happen, you're going to hit somebody, you're out the next game. What? Well, he came up on me. I don't care who came up on who. You just have to know. You can't do that. Well, they don't know. They think they're playing a pickup game, and you said something to me. Yeah? Well, wait a minute. I hate to tell you I go through this every year. It just ages me more the last couple years.
Kyle, you talked about Tyler's swagger this summer. What makes him thrive in these kind of situations when guys are going at him in the crowd?
Now, there's been some games that he didn't thrive at Seton Hall, and there's some other games that he, you know, wasn't thriving. But I'm trying to say to him and Keldon, what do you do to help us win when you're not making shots? So you don't make shots. Don't worry about it. Do all the other stuff to help us win ball games.
John, what did it say about your young team today in a hostile environment that they came out and played the way they did, especially like Tyler and Ashton?
Who's talking to me?
Right here, over here.
Oh, they.
Favorite person.
Yeah, it was a good effort. It was a good fight. It was a game that you knew you were going to have to come in and battle. I just, you know, for us, it's nice to be in games where the other team has as much to lose as we do. 90% of our games, the other team has nothing to lose, and they're jacking up balls, falling into seats, double clutching, hitting lights, the ball goes in. He's made three threes. That's the first three threes he's made all year. He's not made any except he just made three. I mean, this is a game, including the last game we played. Both teams had something to lose. And, you know, it was a for us to be in that environment, we've been there now almost every game we played.
Cal, down here to your left, did you go back and do kind of try to find what you had in the Bahamas that you lost early in the season and whatever it was, have you found it?
Yeah, I was trying to schedule those teams. I wanted them to come back. And the
there
guy
was like
from,
a confidence about the,
guy,
the team.
Yeah, but the guy from – what was that team from? Where was that guy? The Lithuania team said too far. What was the other guy? I tried to get him back on his schedule, say if we play them, we're going to be confident and happy and everybody's going to do their thing. Look, there was things that happened, and I said I'm not intoxicated by what happened down there, but I probably was. The beginning of this year, we were a bad defensive team. We had a bunch of unwilling passers. In other words, I'm only passing if I don't have a shot. We had guys that were so focused on themselves, they couldn't play for us. And you know what? I missed it as a coach. I missed it. But after I saw it, then it was like, all right, we're going back to these things, and we're going to get better at this stuff. And you know, there are times I make mistakes. What? I think it was 1978, 77, 78, something like that, that you screw up and you got to start all over. Well, guess what? But these kids are doing exactly what I'm asking them to do, so if it's not working, don't be mad at them. No one should get mad at these kids. They're 18 and 19-year-old. They're just out of high school. I got one grad student. He and I sit on the bus together and talk politics and stuff. The other guys look at us like we're both crazy. But – you know, it's this is the process you go through. But I never lost any confidence in the kids. I told them that. But you're going to have to play different. My latest message, and it's just as much a holiday message to them, if you create opportunities for others, you're going to create more opportunities for yourself. If you create opportunities for others, you'll create more opportunities for yourself. A little bit spiritual, but it pertains to basketball too. So PJ had 8 assists. Now, you seeing him play right now? He had 8 assists last game. He created for his teammates, and everybody talked about PJ. Ashton, all he's doing is trying to run the team and get people involved, and they're talking about him. And so I'm telling the rest of the guys, if you're willing passers, if you create for each other, you're going to create more for yourself. That is not only in basketball, that's in life.
Coach, if you could just talk about the fact that your team only has 5 second chance points today. You have your trio of freshman guards come out, score 50 combined between those. What does that mean that your team can go out there and play that well from the perimeter, even when you're not necessarily dominating on the offensive backboards?
Well, again, we out-rebounded these guys, but they're both of us are great rebounding teams. And you had their guys, Nuora, coming from the perimeter, just flying in. And we weren't blocking him out. Great lesson for us. Ours is more we're around that goal playing some mush mouth. But, you know, look, we can play fast and win. We can play and grind it out and win. We got to learn how to play late in games. We got to learn how to play down 8-7. How do we play now? There's so many situations that we're trying to work on right now because we have the time. And we're still in camp. We're still going 2 and 3 times a day. We'll go. They have 2 days off. They have the rest of today off. And they have tomorrow off. Then we start up Monday. And we're going twice on Tuesday, twice, 3 times on Wednesday. We don't have anything else to do except video games. So we're practicing. We're together. We're watching film. We're going over situations. This is the best time of the year for my teams.
Coach.
Yeah. But let me say this. If we're going to do something special, it'll be with Nick. We got to figure out how we play those two, because EJ was really good again today. He's really good. He's a really good player. Who is he as good as PJ and Reed in some areas, but he's just not physically as tough as those guys yet. But Nick gives us that seven-footer blocking shots, but today he couldn't get a rebound. So I went with EJ and said, EJ, you'll play. And I told him after the game, I'm not mad at you, but your minutes were based on your performance, and we need you to win.
Coach, back here to your right, by the camera, sorry. You seem to control the tempo throughout, but you also had higher foul totals than U of L throughout the whole game. Were those simply mistakes, or were you willing to trade foul trouble for intimidation and aggression?
At one point, I did not want to look up and see the foul differential. But I do know late in the game, we only had a couple. And again, you know what? We're playing basketball. We're an aggressive team. If there's body contact and they're, you know, they're going against us, they go against us. I mean, it's, I've done this long enough that, you know, if I need to get a technical, I will. If I don't need to, today I didn't think I needed to. There were some calls that I questioned, and I told them, hey, my only thing is, I just, whatever you're calling on one end, call down the other, and then I'm good. You know, if you're calling walks on us, just call walks on them. If you're calling, they're doing this one like he didn't go straight up, well, then do that down that end too. And then I'm fine. I'm not going to say anything. But if I'm seeing this, but they went straight, then I say something. So,
you made a reference earlier to the bandwagon of fans, and I think that was facetious.
Was it?
Would you encourage?
What happened?
Would you encourage your fans to climb on that bandwagon now?
Look, the fans that have really followed how I've done this for 10 years never moved. The fans that are mad that our kids are in the NBA making $1.5 billion, that they're not changing. But the reality of it is, the fans that really follow us, they know this is a process. We've had teams, folks, that went till late February before they got it. And our fans stuck with it. Now the others, they were chirping and doing their thing. I don't pay attention to it. If it gets crazy, I'll say, Eric, is there anything I need to deal with? No, there's just nothing. I don't watch it. I don't read it. So if you're on the internet or you're sending me emails, I don't have email, so you can't send me email. If I need to talk to somebody, I go in the bathroom, I turn the water on. I mean, you're not emailing me. You're not. I don't read the Twitter, the Facebook. I don't read it. If I need it, he'll say, yeah, it's, you know, da-da-da. What are they, what? I'm mad at, you know, what? And it kind of makes me laugh, but we have the greatest fan. Let me just say this. As a coach, Kentucky is like what you want. You never have to sell a ticket. You never have to worry about people being excited about games. You could play in a storm, and there's 20,000 people in that building. You know that the hardcore people adopt these players and they become their sons and grandsons. But you also know that there's a small percentage out there that they're crazy. I don't pay any attention to them. Now, here's the good thing. They'll never steal my joy. They never will. And I don't listen to you. So you make yourself angry and go crazy. Make yourself angry and go crazy. And I'll be smiling. Why is he always smiling? That guy just smiles all the time. They're having fun. Yeah, woof, Auburn, Mississippi State, no one even knows about yet. They're really good. I mean, the whole league is, like, ridiculous. But and you won't believe this, we're playing the top five teams twice. Really? Yeah. So everybody that's really good, we got twice. And it is what it is. I just told them before this game, I said, guys, we got 9 more of these, just like this. They're packed. They were in line waiting on tickets. They had it marked on their calendar. They canceled weddings. That's what they do when we come to town. So get used to it. And this team's going to play well, and let's have fun with it. So,
thanks, guys.
Happy holidays to everybody.